Hello, everypony, and welcome back to Fandom Fridays, where we proceed to check out all the fanfics that are not pony related. Why? Because I just finished Breath of the Wild and I'm feeling a little down. Gentlemen, I think it's time to admit it. It's time to just sit down and think. Legend of Zelda franchise is one of the greatest video games ever. That is all. Thank you. So, why is it that I haven't had a chance to put in a Zelda fanfic? I mean, you'd think as much as I love the franchise and have played almost all the games and have watched the series and can say that the episodes of Link on Captain N are my favorites, Zelda hasn't shown up yet on the show. Sheeran's got more episodes than Link. Samus has more episodes somehow. I think it's because I just hadn't found one that interested me yet. I'm very peculiar about my Legend of Zelda fix, you know. So, how about we read a one based off of Skyward Sword? Well, for the first time ever, we're going to do a fanfic from Tumblr. As we check out something from the Sky Family Tumblr, Legend of Zelda. First Birth. Beginnings. Enjoy. Beginnings. First Birth. From the Ask the Sky Family Tumblr. I'm so sorry, I don't have a author's name on this fic. Wow, this is the first time I've ever had this happen to me. I'll be going now. You okay? Yeah, I'm just so used to reading weird screen names that not having one just makes me feel down. Poor guy. I'll take over. Thank you. Part 1.4, First Birth. The sky that day seemed to be unable to decide if it wanted to rain or shine, so it settled for a combination of the two, with most of the sky shrouded in dark clouds and the occasional ray of sunlight filtering through. It was fresh and breezy, however, so Link and Zelda decided to stroll through the forest to collect some of Zelda's favorite fruit. Link had originally asked her to stay behind and rest since he had woken up, feeling slightly under the weather, but she insisted the walk and fresh air would do her and the baby good. She was nearly 7 months through, but her belly was already exhibiting the signs of a 9-month pregnancy. Though they guessed it simply looked big because of Zelda's petite form. The baby had been particularly active that morning, and Zelda would occasionally feel a cramping up sensation in her lower abdomen, which she was told would be normal the further she got into her pregnancy. She would also wake up feeling dizzy or uncomfortable, and she'd feel her cheeks warm up and feel short of breath for unknown reasons. But other than that, she felt fine, and decided to accompany Link in the early morning collecting. She hurt her arm with his as he picked up fruit with his usual basket and dagger, which he would cut down the fruit. After exchanging a good morning kiss, they made their way down to the eastern gates towards Farron Woods, right towards the Lake of Floria, where the juices fruit grow. As they walked, Link noticed Zelda made a face as he put her other hand over her sullen stomach. "Then, someone is laughing today," she commented with a side smile as she felt the baby moving around in the womb. Link couldn't help but grin. "Boy or girl, there'll be a good night in the future by the looks of it." He put a hand on her belly, a smile widening when he felt the little creature respond to his voice in the form of a kick. "Well, I know someone who was a real sleepy head, and he turned out to be the best night of all." She looked at him from the corner of her eye with a wide smile, and Link merely chuckled, scratching the back of his head. "Well, yeah, I guess. But at least he won't sleep around as often." "For the sake of my sanity, I hope so. Or the first months would be pretty difficult." They both chuckled as they followed the path. After a few minutes, Zelda expressed sadness and asked if restless wooziness overcame her again. Link nodded, set down his cloak on a bare patch of grass at the base of a tree, and sat her down. He handed her his canteen, from which she drank thirstily. "Better?" he asked, stroking her stomach.
"A little," Zelda said, sighing. "It suddenly got so hot."
Link felt fine, but I guess that was yet another symptom of her condition.
So, he merely offered her the rest of his canteen to stay cool. I'm sorry, I just became a burden to you, Zelda said, apologetically, taking another sip from his container. Nonsense. The cool air will do you good. He smiled sweetly and gave her a peck on the lips. I'll go fetch some fruit. Go get some rest. The tree's just ahead. I won't be long. All right. Zelda reclined against the tree and drunk once Link had gone off to collect the yellow fruit and pressed a hand against her temple. Her head felt light. She felt something strange in her midsection, like a dull pressure. She was not due yet, but maybe the prenatal symptoms had begun to show up. Whatever it was turning out to be quite uncomfortable. Why do I have a feeling that Nehru is just messing with Link right about now? Link cut the last fruit from the branch and flung it into the basket hanging from his back. He jumped off happily into the tree, content with the haul he had gotten today. Was Zelda's favorite, nonetheless. He made his way back to Zelda, but his smile faltered when he saw the peculiar expressions she was making. She looked nauseated. He ran towards her, kneeling at her side. Zelda, are you okay? Zelda moaned softly as he clutched her middle. A worry quickly filled his mind. Dizzy? She murmured. Come on, I'll take you home. Link moved to carry her, but Zelda shook her head, placing a hand against his chest. I'll walk, she says weakly, and stood up with Link's help. What happened? He asked her as he began to make her way back at a slow pace Zelda felt comfortable with. I don't know. It just got really warm all of a sudden. It hurts right here. Zelda gestured towards her midsection, and Link furrowed his brows. Is that normal? I don't know. Just ask Gwynna. Oh, love. It really hurts. Her voice hits, and the grip around his arm tightened. Don't worry. We're almost there. Link tried to sound soothing, but he was getting concerned. He knew close to nothing about childbirth, except what the elder man had told him about. Which wasn't much, since it was customary that childbirth be handled solely by women, with the men fairly intervening. And needless to say, the things he had overheard from the older women were nothing short of horrifying. Once Zelda had found out she was expecting, there was much rejoicing from everyone in the village. After all, they were a pretty close community. The women were particularly excited, wondering about everything from gender it be, or what Zelda and Link would call it, right down to the most inane things like favorite colors. But sometimes, they touched upon grimmer topics, such as complications or deformities that could occur during pregnancy. Link had been left quite agitated by what he had heard, but Grus had continuously reassured him that things would be fine, and women tended to exaggerate things. However, it never linked to Link's mind, and he always saw to it that Zelda's needs were fulfilled, and that he received the best care possible. Until now, things had been going off without a hitch. Maybe Zelda was getting close to giving birth? Link allowed himself the momentary wave of excitement to always rush through him whenever he thought about their oncoming child. Back when Zelda had told him she was expecting, he was ecstatic. And now, he was eagerly anticipating it like a child waiting to meet his watchling for the first time. Suddenly, he felt a tug at his arm. He realized he had unconsciously started walking faster. He paused to allow Zelda to catch up, muttering an apology to her. When no reply came, Link looked back at her, growing worried when he noticed her unfocused eyes, faltering steps. She seemed to be breathing laboriously, and beads of sweat had begun to form on her temple. Zelda! Abruptly, Zelda's eyes rolled to the back of her head and her knees gave out beneath her. Link gasped, rushed to stop her fall, holding her in his arms before she touched the ground. Zelda! He knelt down, cradling her in his arms, while he felt a surge of panic consume him. Zelda, what's wrong? But she lay limp in his arms, her face flushed and beads of sweat rolling down her temple. Oh, goddess. Hold on, Zelda! He picked her up in his arms and rushed towards the village in search for help, all the while his heart clenching with dread. Link paced about the room, arms behind back, and his face constricted with worry.
He'll make a hole in your living room if you keep that up.
Link looked at Grus, sitting on the couch with his arms crossed. Then he heaved a sigh. Grus had been the first to hear Link as he called for help, so the bulkier knight had rushed off to call Love and Olan, the resident healers, to find out what was wrong with Zelda. The two were quick to respond to the call, bringing their supplies and pulses with them to diagnose and treat Zelda. It had been about an hour before they began, and worry ate at Link's insides. Both Alwan and Love had deemed that Link was too skittish to remain in the room with Zelda, and sent him to wait downstairs.
Relax, bud, the Red Knight said. He'll be alright. It must be some pregnant women stuff.
Hope so.
Link said in a low voice, finding a seat beside Cruz. Cruz shook his head and gave him a hearty pat on the back before he stayed up and made his way outside.
I need to head back to my shift. I won't hear the end of it from Pippet. Just let keep me a know, okay?
Link nodded quietly. Cruz smiled once and left through the door, leaving Link to tap his boots against the stone floor nervously. Half an hour later, Lincoln finally heard the sounds of footsteps coming from the stairs. He stood up just as Alon reached the last steps. The white-haired man had a pensive expression on his face. Once he had caught sight of Link expectantly for him, motioned him to sit at the table. Link obeyed and was promptly joined by the professor, who sat across from him.
So?
Link asked, his words laced with apprehension.
How is she?
Alon stayed silent for a few moments as he, with a hand on his chin, as if pondering his answer before laying it out to Link. He then closed his eyes and opened them again after a few moments.
Stable.
Stable?
Yes. We've given her some potions and herbs to help alleviate her symptoms. She is resting right now, and Nerve is looking after her. I must ask you to give her time to tend to Zelda, alright? She'll let you know when it's time to see her.
Yes, sir, Link said, swelling nervously.
Now, I want to ask you a few questions, Link. Zelda is 7.5 months due, correct?
Link nodded. Yes, almost 8.
Have you noticed her acting strangely before today? What about her health?
Well, not strange, particularly beyond food cravings. Link racked his mind to check if he had noticed something. The last few weeks, he felt a little weak and dizzy, though. But we thought it was normal since he would feel fine a few hours afterwards.
I see.
As Link closed his eyes again, thinking,
any odd pains or complaints?
So you said that she would feel a pressure in her head, like a headache. But a potion would always fix that. Link thought some more. And, well, before she passed out today, she mentioned her midsection hurt a lot. Ellen furrowed his brows, humming momentarily to himself. Is she all right? Link asked, rubbing his hands nervously beneath the table.
Link, you know I'm not the type to sugarcoat things, so I'll tell it to you straight,
Alan said. Link could already feel himself tensing, but nodded regardless. All right.
Zelda seems to have developed complications.
Complications? Link's chest constricted painfully.
While prenatal complications are rare in and of themselves, some kinds of complications are more commonly seen than others. Seeing Zelda has developed one of the most common conditions that can arise during pregnancy.
And how bad is it? Link asked cautiously, not really wanting to know, but at the same time knowing he had to find out.
Very precarious.
Link gulped down the lump that began to form his throat.
Bluntly speaking, if not treated properly, you can lose one or lose them both.
The color on Link's face drained, eyes widening. Lose? Zelda? And there? His? No! Link choked out, eyes stinging.
Before you let yourself lose your head, please realize that none of it is your fault. Some women are just more prone to developing these kinds of conditions, no matter who the father is.
You would think that somebody with the power to Triforce would be able to avoid this, but no! But Link was not listening, his mind running rampant with what he had just been told. He shot up from his seat suddenly, slamming his hands on the table and accidentally knocking his chair back.
What do you need?
Link asked him, voice desperate. I'll do anything. Whatever agreement or plot you need, I'll get him.
Link, calm down,
Alan ordered, waving a hand to the distressed youth.
We have all the inconvenience we need to treat Zelda and help her through it. We just need time and patience and force Zelda to be in a stress-free environment, which she won't get with you around in the state you are in. I told you this because as her husband, I felt it was right to let you know, not for you to lose control. I suggest you take a walk around town and cool your head. Zelda is in good hands right now, and that the best you could do for her is wait.
But, Link stammered, eyes simmering. He lowered his hand to faint. He felt more than saw Aslan stick up, and slowly from his seat, around the table to place a reassuring hand on Link's shoulder.
I know how you feel, Link, Alan said softly, but there are demons that must be fought, not with blades of steel, but with patience and care. Do not fear. Zelda is strong. She will make it.
Link looked down with glassy eyes, nice, slowly understanding.
This will likely trigger her body to going labor early, so we'll be ready if that happens. However, Zelda might find solace in your support, so I'll ask you to be completely composed by then. Am I clear?
He nodded once again. The instructor gave him a comforting smile, a squeeze on his shoulder before he left for the door.
I will head back and concoct some more medicine for Zelda. I shall also ask Gwenda and Miss Kikui to assist Link and to assist Louvre. In the meantime, try to distract yourself.
The instructor left without another word, leaving Link with his increasingly troubled thoughts and anxiety that gripped every part of his being. Link begrudgingly left the house when Werner and Kikui arrived, claiming that they let him know about any changes and that he should take a break. Zelda was better off being taken care of by two women, one of already had children of her own, than have him, currently a bundle of worry, pacing around non-stop. That was most certain. So he left in spite of his feelings. After walking around aimlessly, and as far away from possible the bustle of town, Link finally made up his mind to take a watch on the southern gate wall, which was most of the time unmanned, and had a good view of his home. Link avoided meeting anyone desperately, attempting to find his mind too jumbled to hold a decent conversation with anyone. And truth be told, he began to feel so plagued by remorse, he didn't feel like talking to anyone. He climbed the ladder just beside the main southern gate and walked down to the battlement. Relieved no one was there. He walked a few paces further, until he was directly behind and above his home. While nothing could be seen further inside, he could still catch the flicker of lamplight coming from the window, directly his and Zelda's room on the second floor. He caught the faint movement of the shadows within the room from time to time, but other than that, he was left in the dark, uncertain of how Zelda was feeling right at this moment. A light drizzle began to fall in as every evening rolled in, but paying no attention. His mind drifted off, driven by the chain of negative thoughts that had begun to take a hold of him. He recalled well the day when he had overheard the women talking about Zelda. Like Link, he just found out Zelda was 3 months along in her pregnancy, and pretty excited about the prospect of the daughter of the patriarch and the Academy's most astounding knight having their first baby. Link had not attempted to eavesdrop on their conversation, but he just happened to be fixing a lamplight nearby as the women washed their dirty clothes in the village's laundry pool. Their cheery conversation had slowly diverged to less pleasant topics, ranging from birth defects to stillborns, and even the possibility of death during childbirth. He had not wished any of these on Zelda by any means, but the topic just seemed to spring up to keep the women entertained. Link, however, had been unable to leave, frozen by shock at the myriad of things that could go wrong in a pregnancy. He was left pretty sinking and anxious, even after the women had long left the laundry pool. And that night, he had been unable to tell Zelda why he was still jumping. She soon forgot about it, but Link still molded over in his sleep. What if? The question had his mind plagued ever since. Even when he vented to Groose about it, the red-haired man could only shake his head, telling that he was overthinking things, and he shouldn't take the female gossip seriously. Groose had calmed him down somewhat, but worry still clung to his heart. Due to this, Link had done his hardest to be the most diligent husband he could, making sure all Zelda's needs were covered, down to the most ridiculous cravings or the most inane of intentions. He watched over her like a female loftwing with her fledglings, and had gotten to the point Zelda had asked him to tone it down, because he was bothering and overbearing.
Link, you're fussing over me again,
she would say with a rather amused tone. And Link would bow his head and apologetically mutter a distracted sorry. Despite all that, despite all of his efforts to keep her safe and sound and healthy, the very thing he had feared was unfolding right before his very eyes.
You could lose one or both of them.
He felt coldness wash over him, and Aslan's words rang in his ears like a deafening curse. Zelda's illness put her in such a precarious position that there was a chance that she, the baby, or both would not make it out. And it was all his fault. Link gave an involuntary shudder, clenching his eyes shut. Link knew this condition was directly linked to childbirth, and deep down he couldn't keep himself from taking the blame for bringing this upon Zelda. He had been the idiot who first suggested having a baby, the one who convinced Zelda they were ready for the next big step. If he had only known. It takes two to create a child, but Zelda had shouldered most of the burden. As if it wasn't enough she was alone, she had to go through the morning sickness and other little nuances for 9 months straight. Now her life and the life of their child were both in danger. He could do nothing but watch. Link slammed the fist against the stone in helpless frustration. The drizzle turned into a downpour before long, as if reacting to his grief.
His eyes stung and his chest constricted painfully with a surge of emotions that suddenly assailed him, driving him to his knees. He had hurt the very person he had sworn to protect, led her straight to death's door for the sake of his own careless wish.
Goddess, damn you!
He cursed himself, letting his silent tears fall and mingle with the rain, soaking his clothes and skin. If he could only offer his life to ensure hers and his child's, had he had the choice, he would do it without a second thought. He was unaware of how much time had passed since he had taken watch over the southern battlement. The sheets of rain were thick, but by the darkness that shrouded the whole village, he could tell that night had fallen. He could faintly see the pinpricks of light in the main plaza, and the lamplight still flickered in the window that he had taken vigil on. How was he doing? He wondered. He wanted nothing more than to see her and be assured she would be all right. He knew Zelda was strong, but he couldn't live with the idea that she was in any kind of pain, that he was helpless to stop it, especially when he had contributed to bringing it upon her. Guilt continued to tear him apart from inside. Despite being the one with an unbreakable spirit and bearing the mark of the Triforce, he certainly didn't feel very powerful, wise, or courageous. He felt helpless, stupid, and very much afraid for the life of the person he loved most, and regret consumed every part of his being. His thoughts had turned so grim, and despite that he even let himself entertain the thought, the only way for Zelda to survive would be to lose the other one. Except that fate. He knew Zelda would chastise him for that thought, scolding him and calling him all the colorful names in the book for being so heartless. But he couldn't help it. It was the thought that killed him on the inside, especially since he had been the most excited of the two, what would be the new addition to the family. But he was beyond distraught now, sick of worrying and guilt. He wanted nothing more than for Zelda to be out of harm's way. He gave a broken moan and trembled. He was chilled to the bone, having spent time under the rain for far too long. But he didn't care. He let the rain cover him. It only served him right. But no sooner had he begun to think that the rain was a divine sign of his foolishness, he felt the drops suddenly stop falling. Something warm and heavy fall on his shoulders and head. He looked up startled, and found him standing out another than Zelda's father. His heart sank to the pit of his stomach, but the old man simply regarded him calmly, extending his hand out and inviting him to take cover from the rain under his umbrella. Link swallowed nervously before he stood up and walked to his side, wrapping the cloak tightly around him.
You'll chance your death out here if you don't watch yourself,
the headmaster commented softly as they began walking down the battlement. Link couldn't help but flinch at the choice of words he had made, shrinking back into his cloak. At the lack of reply, the headmaster simply continued speaking in a low, subdued voice.
Grus has been looking all over for you. You've had everyone worried.
Link merely looked down in shame. I'm sorry, Link said in a tired, raspy voice. The headmaster only gave it a pleasant laugh.
Don't apologize to me. Apologize to them.
No, Link corrected, shaking his head. I'm sorry for putting your daughter through this. Gaporo just raised his eyebrows slightly.
Whatever do you mean, boy?
It took every ounce of will for him not to break down in front of his elder. It's my fault. I did that to her. If not for me, she wouldn't be in the condition she's in right now. He raised his voice without meaning to, his words coming out broken and tight. Gaporo stopped in his tracks and laid a hand on Link's shoulder, forcing him to turn around and face him.
Listen to me, Link, Gaporo said, but firmly. I want you to erase that thought from your mind.
But
this is not your fault. These things just lend themselves. There was no way you could have known what would happen to Zelda. You are a hero, Link. But there will be things you can't protect people from, including my daughter.
Gaporo dug his deep black eyes in Link's worry-filled blue once, his voice laced with emotion.
I won't lay a lie and say that I'm not worried. I'm terrified. But I know my daughter is tough, and she'll make it through. You've done so much for her already, Link. But I must ask that you keep it together and help her by keeping yourself strong. She needs it more now than ever.
Link hesitated but nodded silently.
You remind me so much of your father.
The headmaster started with a soft, melancholic voice, patting Link's hair gently.
He wouldn't ever stop blaming himself for your mother's death.
Link knew that very well. He hadn't missed his mother since he had died giving birth to him. But what little time he had spent with his father as a small child, He recalled him visiting her grave often, sometimes lamenting about how sorry he did that to her. Little Lake never understood why he did that until his father had met his end during duty, and Link was left under Kipora's wing in the academy, where he learned everything about his parents.
Birds of a feather, you two were.
Kipora finished with an amused smile.
Both with thick enough skulls that you did not learn to chew more than you can eat. Some burdens are just not yours to carry, understood?
Link gave him a half-hearted smile in return. Yes, sir. Kipora caught the hand on his shoulder comfortably, giving him a small smile. He then gestured Link towards the ladder at the edge of the southern gate.
Run along now. Get yourself dried up before you catch a cold,
Kipora said. Not shortly after, Link had heard Chris's voice, calling him from the bottom of the wall.
Oi! There you are! We're looking all over for you. What do you think you're doing?
The red-haired man reprimanded him, a hand on his waist and another on the umbrella that he was holding to shield himself from the lake. Link looked back at Kipora and nodded solemnly, bowing his head momentarily in both respect and gratitude. Thank you, sir. Kipora smiled very warmly at him.
I do believe Zelda could have married a finer man. Keep it up, son.
Link simply caught me a coy smile, feeling the warmth seep into his cheeks at his surrogate father's compliment. As Link started lowering himself down the stepladder, he heard Kipora shoot him one last compliment.
And I look forward to meeting that grandson of mine,
he finished with a wink. Link managed a half-hearted smile and slipped down the rest of the way to where Groose was staying with him. Link blew gingerly on the tub of key that he had been given as soon as he got to Groose's house. Thank you, Petrus, Link said meekly.
Oh, just mention it.
The blonde woman smiled warmly at him as he eased the towel over the green-clad hero to dry himself.
If my darling hadn't found you, though, Petrus said with a dreaming voice, being wet wouldn't be the only thing you were worrying about.
Link chuckled good-naturedly as he watched Petrus surround Groose's waist with her arms. This was the only part she could read. Link found a difference in height endearing, with Beatrice's petite form pretty contrasting to Groose's big, muscular build. Groose blushed slightly at Beatrice's rain compliments on him. He looked genuinely enjoying himself, though.
Yeah, well,
Groose started, picking up a large hand on our little shoulder.
Someone has to look out for the little runt.
Wouldn't have chosen anyone better, Groose, Link added, taking a sip of his drink as he eased himself into their couch, wrapped a towel around himself.
Well, I'll go fix up dinner,
Petrus announced happily before she went off into the kitchen. Once he was gone, Groose rounded him with a scowl.
What are you trying to do? Get yourself sick? Think it'll help Zelda?
Link's eyes widened at the sudden accusation, but he just lowered his head, resting his hands on his lap and stroking the edge of a cup of his thumb. I lost track of time, Link replied in a low voice. I didn't do it on purpose. Groose's expression softened, seeing how gently remorseful his friend looked. Of course, he didn't do it on purpose. Link never tried to do anything that might worry him or hurt others. But in his distress about Zelda, he was doing just that, neglecting himself.
You need to take it easy, Link,
he said with a sigh, taking a seat beside him and resting elbows on his knees.
I asked Zelda to come over and look over you, just to make sure you haven't caught anything, alright? That's the last thing you need.
Link nodded softly, muttering a soft thank you under his breath.
Everything will be fine, you'll see,
Groose said, patting his head nonchalantly. I'm just so worried. Link's hold on his cup tightened. He could feel the onslaught of emotions threatening to take hold of him again. But he did his best to rein it in. I feel so guilty.
Well, knock it off. You're not guilty of anything.
Groose flicked the side of Link's hand. She wouldn't be like this if she wasn't expecting.
Oi! Don't start that again! Kipora told me everything about you blaming and feeling sorry for yourself. I'll have none of that!
In the myriad of feelings he was expecting in that moment, Link felt one he didn't feel often keep up. Irritation. Why wasn't anyone as concerned as he was about Zelda's well-being? Why did everyone act like Zelda would just magically heal herself as if nothing could happen? It wasn't that simple. And it tore at Link's soul to know it wasn't. This wasn't a matter of sprinkling pink fairy dust on it to make everything better. It didn't work that way. Well, if I could bring out a freaking pink fairy, I could, you know, maybe fix a couple of things up. Pink fairies did not fix death. They prevented it right at the nick of time,
but there were limits to their power. They could not cure illnesses, they could not alleviate their painful symptoms, but the end result was inevitable. It was all so grossly inconvenient.
These things happen, but don't look up. Mark my words, you're making a hurricane out of a breeze.
Easy for you to say. It's not your wife dying!
Link blurted out before he could stop himself. But he instantly regretted as Scrooge rounded on him with the most ticked-off expression he had ever seen him bark.
And what's that supposed to mean? The knight asked curtly. Are you even somewhat successful? I don't care about what happens to Zelda.
I didn't say that. Link stood up, placing a cup on a table, and shrugging the towel off his shoulders as he walked away.
Yeah, enough. Thanks for your hospitality.
As soon as Link laid a hand on the doorknob, Grew sprung up from the couch and slammed the door shut again, for Link barely opened it.
Oh no, you aren't going anywhere,
Grew said, shoving him back.
Going to go mope and feel sorry for yourself in another corner of the village? Great good, that'll do.
Link stilled his tongue before he said anything else. Anger had started to boil up in the pit of his stomach. But he knew it was misplaced, and it was just the circumstance weighing on him, right?
You say it's easy for me to say that, because it's not Pietro's that Zelda's place. I find it more endearing you've got so little faith in Zelda. You're her husband, for crying out loud!
Scuffed Cruz, pointing to an accusatory finger out.
I'm aware of what I am!
Link spat back, not caring to the anger matter.
I don't need you to tell me that. Then act like it. Zelda needs you. You're acting like a child. Whatever happened to the goddess's chosen hero?
Well, must good those powers do now, don't they? Link scoffed, face red in anger as he threw his arms in the air in frustration. Won't even help me save her. They're nothing but a stupid mark on my hand. That's all they're good for.
For God's sakes, Link, you saved her from the Apocalypse's heartbreaker herself. You suddenly feel like it was all for nothing?
What use was saving her from that if I'm only going to lose her later? Chris took Link by surprise by grabbing him by the shoulders and slamming against the wall.
Zelda's out there, fine, survive, while you're standing here, already killing her in your mind.
Chris said in a dazedly dark tone,
you ought to be ashamed of yourself. What a hero you turned out to be.
Link's eyes widened as Grus's words struck something in his mind. What was he doing? Had worry really lured him to the level of a hopeless child? Zelda would be so disappointed. Link felt something prick at the corner of his eyes, while he merely slunk down to the floor, calling moan escaping his lips. Slight of horror caused his eyes set in shame. Grus's shoulders slack, and pity occupied the place anger had been in his face. The door creaked open suddenly, and Grus turned around to see Alan enter the abode. His white eyebrows rose slightly as he saw Link crumple on the floor.
Dude, did I miss something? Yeah, but you have great timing.
Grus cocked his head downwards, and Link and Alan mentally muttered a knowledgeable ah.
May I use your kitchen, then? Suit yourself. Petrus can help you. Thank you kindly.
Alan bowed his head slightly, for he made his way to the kitchen, carrying a bag of supplies soon.
Come on, Nell, Grus said, helping Link up. You need a break, bud.
Link simply shook his head, a screw sat on the couch again, and he rested his elbows on his knees, boring his face in his hands, groaning loudly.
I'm sorry, Grus, Link muttered in shame. I lost myself,
Shut it. Don't worry about it. I understand where you're coming from, but someone needs to keep your head on the ground before you get any more crazy thoughts, yeah?
Link smiled appreciatively, nodding his head at his friend. Still felt mentally exhausted from worry, but Grus's words had at least made the anger fade. A little while later, Alan exited the kitchen, carrying a steaming cup of tea on his hand, and handed it eagerly to Link.
Drink this, it'll soothe your nerves, Alan told him, after Link saw him a questioning look. It might also help extinguish any worrying signs of a cold, in case they had started to develop.
Link muttered a thank you before he sipped on his hot tea, instantly feeling the warmth sleep through every fiber of his being. The taste was mildly sweet, but pleasant, before Link had emptied the cup.
Thank you, he yawned, rubbing his eyes as he gave the cup back. It does make me feel better.
Alan nodded. I'm glad. So why don't you lie down for a while?
I can't. I need to stay up in case Zelda... Another young broke his groggy voice. Needs anything. Before he could finish, Link's eyes closed heavily and he fell back on the couch, sound asleep. Link was unaware of how much time had passed when he blinked himself awake again.
stared confusedly around the room, and didn't even recall falling asleep. He steadied himself and found someone who placed a warm blanket over him. A snore beside him alerted him of Groose, sleeping soundly on the seat beside him on the couch. Sorry himself stretched across the back, and his head pulled back with mouth wide open. Link caught an eyebrow, then turned around as he caught movement in the corner of his eye. He found Alan standing on the chair, grinning calmly with a book by the campfire. Confused, Link stood up and walked over to take a seat across from Alan, dead silence.
Pietro's left you some food on the counter,
Alan said without looking away from his book.
Thought might you still being hungry.
Ah, thanks, Link said meekly. What time is it?
Around 4 in the morning.
4 in the morning? Link exclaimed in alarm. But he was silenced as Alan detached his eyes from his book, assuming a disapproving glare.
Keep it down, you'll wake everyone.
Sorry, he apologized. But how could I sleep so long?
I'm sorry, Link, but you were behaving so irrationally, we had to put you to sleep. I hope you didn't hold it against Cruz. He meant well.
Link just stared, and he gaped. So that's why you'd fallen asleep right after the tea. Link couldn't help but arrest in a groan of frustration. Still, he could not blame Groose for asking Alan to give him a sleeping potion to chill him out. It's being quite unreasonable.
Missing sleep is not quite like you, it seems, Alan said with an amused half-smile. So Groose had grown concerned.
I see. I do feel a lot calmer, though. Thanks, sir.
Not a problem.
Link sighed after a while, and quickly jumped to Aaron, really interested in him. How's Zelda? Alan smiled.
She is out of danger,
he said, and smiled widely when he saw Link's eyes shining with relief.
It's quite a struggle, but she made it through the worst of it. You have an admirable wife, Link.
Link relaxed on his seat, laying his head back as he gave a sigh. He smiled as Grisha's words only hours ago came back to him. She is extraordinary, Link agreed, feeling a chunk of his burden elevate. It was like a huge weight had been lifted from him.
However,
Alan's words caught him by surprise, and Link had to right himself before he lost his footing on his chair.
Like I told you before, her efforts had a chance of leading her into labor early.
And is that bad? Link asked as a concern returned full force home.
It's not necessarily bad, but it could be risky for the child,
Alan explained.
It's only 7.5 months, though, so it hasn't reached the utmost state of maturity. However, it's possible everything goes down smoothly with no problems. Try not to worry too much over it.
Link nodded. He's not quite as convinced. But she'll be fine, right? Link asked securely. Now let her guard with neutral face.
As of now, Zelda has gone into premature labor 2 times. She's been left very weak and exhausted battling her illness. So, it might take a while before you're able to see your child. But yes, she is fine. She's just heading to your home right now. It's possible you could be allowed to see her now that the worst of it has passed. It might do Zelda good to see you. I told you won't stop asking about you.
Thank you for everything! Link immediately stood up, bowed his head to Zelda, and headed out the door. Please say thanks to Groose for me!
Will do.
Link left the house and sprinted through the plaza. Due to the time of night, it was completely empty. Other than saluting the occasional patrolling knight, Link stopped for nothing. The rain had ceased by now, leaving a fresh breeze flowing through the village as the moon peeked from between the clouds. Before long, he made it to his home and gingerly opened the door as to not disturb the wall with his noise. Once inside, he found Werna preparing something in the kitchen. The smell of pumpkin wiped it out to Link's nose. She turned around to find some more ingredients for the broth, and she caught sight of Link.
Oh, Link, there you are,
Werna said cheerfully. Though Link could see the dark shadows underneath her eyes, losing sleep.
Why don't you sit down and have some soup? Zelda is sleeping right now.
Ah, sure. Truthfully, Link wanted to rest at Zelda's side and see her. When she was resting, he didn't want to disturb her. He went to the table and sat down, allowing Werna to pour some steaming, warm stuff into a bowl in front of him. I cannot thank you enough, love. Kirkle, enough for looking after Zelda. Link said with a smile, realizing how hungry he had been, as his stomach grumbled in response.
Not a problem, Link,
Werna said happily.
She is doing so well. She went to the labor about an hour ago, but she is resting. You can go see her when you are done with your soup.
Link thanked her again and proceeded to eat his delicious broth. He and Werner chatted the night, and it was through her heart that Link found out the full extent of what Zelda had gone through. seeing that Zelda's defenses had slowly declined the past few weeks, the lady plummeted that morning, her body unable to sustain her of her and the baby, manifesting in the way that it had done before Lincoln found help. Zelda had been made to drink grains of kinds of potions to make up for what her body could not do in its current state, for the sake of keeping both her and her baby in as best health as possible. After long growing hours of drowning in different concoctions, going through all kinds of pains, Zelda's symptoms seemed to finally diminish and reach stable ground. However, her body had felt much more strengthened, and decided to bring a little one into the world, sending a row of contractions assaulting her womb. Winter went on to describe more or less how birthing worked, but Link stopped her when she got to explaining what dilating meant. It made him feel rather uncomfortable and not keen on hearing how Zelda's body was raging, a battle of itself and sinking into more pain.
Well, I think that's pretty much it, Winter said,
as he picked up both of her bowls to place them on the sink and gestured Link towards the stairs.
But you'd like to see her.
Link nodded silently and stood up, swiftly to accompany Werner up. He felt anticipation build inside of him, but as though he had been separated from Zelda for way too long. Once on the second floor, Werner knocked softly on the door and let them know that Link was there to see Zelda, to which she got Link's quiet reply of approval. With a smile, she then opened the door and gestured Link forward. Link entered a dimly lit room, sunken in a deadly silence that was broken only by the soft, slow wheezes coming from Zelda. Love and Cookay were above spy and looked up as they heard the door creak open. The elder woman nodded her head at Link before she and Cookay left the room to give them space. Link swallowed back at the lump that had formed in his throat at the sound of Zelda's discomfort and walked towards the door where he lay. He grabbed a nearby stool and dragged it to Zelda's bedside, hesitantly seating himself beside her. She had not realized yet that he was there. Her eyes were closed, eyebrows still furrowed from the exertion she had done only an hour prior. Her golden hair was disheveled, clinging to her pasty white skin that was damp with sweat. A light, sickly blush that adorned her cheeks was the only hint of color amongst her pallor, and thick, dark bags lined the bottom of her eyes. Pale lips were slightly parted as she breathed him with great difficulty, her chest slowly rising and falling with every breath she took. Tugged painfully at his heart to see her in so much pain. He had mustered all his self-control to keep himself from leaving the room, searching for something, anything that might ease her ache. He ignored the annoying sting in his eyes and vowed to stay strong for her. He swallowed once again as he dunked a piece of cloth in the water basin on her bedside table and wrung it, gently dabbed it across her forehead and neck. Once the shudder flashed through her body, Luke could tell it took her great effort to even crack her eyes open. Grizzly brash, her eyes were dark and sickly, its heaviness and fatigue making them devoid their usual sign. Hey, Link whispered, in a broken voice, trying his hardest to give her a small smile. How you feeling? Her eyes found him right beside her. The corners of her lips pulled up slightly in her attempt at returning the gesture.
I thought, she breathed, your baby is stubborn.
Link gave a half-hearted chuckle. They got it from you, Link replied, trying to lighten the mood with a joke. Zelda smiled weakly in response, and her fingers found his hand beside her. Link gently snaked his fingers around hers, rubbing her knuckles, reassuring with a thumb. He leaned in towards her and placed a warm kiss on her forehead. Do you want me to bring you anything at all? He asked her.
I'm fine, she replied weakly. Please don't leave.
She said the last part in such a helpless way, and Link was surprised he didn't crumble right then and there. Squeezed her hand, he used his other hand to brush some stray strands away from her face, caressing her cheek gently. Okay, he promised. I won't go anywhere.
Thank you.
She sighed and tried to scoot closer to him. Link immediately moved forward, placing his elbows on the bed, allowing her to stay her head on his shoulder. She squeezed his arm in between her head, and the pillow surrounded her, rubbing her shoulder tenderly to keep her warm. He told me you've been doing great. Please hold on a little longer, Zell. A week, was her reply. She raised her head slightly and kissed the edge of his jaw. Guessing on what she really wanted, Link lowered his head and felt her lips with his. She sighed into his mouth and rested her other hand atop the one he had wrapped around her fingers.
I love you,
she muttered. Link felt a chill raining down his spine. Stress and guilt were all eating him from the inside. Instead of soothing him, her declaration had only filled him with dread and sorrow.
His mind couldn't stop twisting it into something like a goodbye. Afraid of his own grim thoughts, he held her closer, trying to push back this dark image that's springing in his mind. Love you too, he said in a faltering voice, pressing a kiss on the top of his head. I love you so much. He remained in a warm embrace for a few minutes before Zelda started wriggling slightly in discomfort. Her hand left his as he pressed it against her swollen stomach, giving off soft whimpering noises. Zelda? Link asked, concerned. Her face had twisted up in expressive pain as he bit the lower lip as her other hand wrapped around the bed sheets.
Again?
Zelda choked, her eyes closed shut.
What? It's coming again?
Zelda gasped and threw her head back against the pillows as a broken scream left her lip. Link's heart began thumping hard in his chest as he tumbled. What to do? Zelda began to whine loudly, a hand clutching her stomach and the other yanking on the bed sheets.
Move!
Link yelled in panic, standing up.
Where now?
Both women entered the room immediately, where they went to Zelda's side to appease her, and left to the water basin to clean her hands and ready the blankets.
All right, dear. I'm coming. Here comes the third round.
Love told Zelda as he watched in the front of the bed and prepared the younger woman.
Hopefully, this is the good one. Are you ready? Oh, I don't think I have a much choice. Ah!
Then a scream ripped through Zelda, and now both hands balled his fists against the bed sheets.
Come on, Zelda. Breathe in and out,
went her co-exer gently. She said so and starts to stamina and posted to Zelda's message. To the ends of the cup to Zelda's lips, so she took a sip.
This will help you hold out and alleviate the pain a little bit, all right?
Zelda nodded her head between gasps, closing her eyes to see a particularly strong contracted hair.
Link!
She wheezed, her hand tumbling around to find him.
Link!
Link snapped out of shock and promptly moved her to the bedside again, taking her fumbling hand and bringing it to his lips. I'm here! I'm here! He said breathlessly as he kept her away from her swaying face with the other hand. Her gasp on his hands tightened, and Link had to force his mouth shut to keep himself from grasping in surprise at the strength of her hold. She continued to writhe, contenting the breathing exercises as Werner was instructing her to do. And all Link could do was hold on to her and caress her arm gently. Every once in a while, Werner could dab the cloth around Zelda's forehead to remove the excess sweat. Link couldn't help but feel useless and at a loss. No matter how much potion Werner gave to Zelda, she still looked very much in pain. He felt helpless. Guilt once again clutched at his heart when his thoughts was a galvan blaming himself for putting Zelda through the situation to begin with.
All right, dear. Puss!
Love said in a strong voice. Once he had gotten Zelda's legs positioned, Zelda tensed as he made the effort, her head rising slightly from the pillow. She focused all her strength into her abdomen. After a couple of seconds, she fell back on the pillow, breathing heavily, her face deeply flushed.
Come on, Zelda! One more time! Come on!
Love encouraged, looked at the edge of the bed sheet so she could track Zelda's progress. Zelda pushed several times. Minutes felt like hours to Link as he felt himself prepping for what was going to happen. And soon, pressing his forehead against her shoulder and letting gentle kisses on the side of her head, whispering, "You could do it," to Zelda every once in a while attempting to distract himself. But her whimpering and crying kept it slightly rooted to reality. Link was beginning to feel the familiar sting in his eyes building up again.
Push!
Love continued, sousing one of Zelda's legs to soothe her. Zelda pushed once again. Was he lasted a very 2 seconds before she fell back, completely drained and exhausted, her face still contorted in deep pain. Tears had begun glistening at the corners of her eyes, and her hand trembled in his hold. Another gut-wrenching yell left her as another contraction hit her as he writhed on the bed, tears finally streaming from her eyes. Link couldn't take it anymore.
Stop!
Werner and Love both looked up in surprise as blurted out,
"Stop it!"
Link repeated, looking at both women pleading eyes.
It's hurting her! Don't be stupid! Love admonished him. It's normal to feel pain. It's part of the process and we can't halt it! But she's sick! She could!
Link couldn't bring himself to say it, but the way his eyes had begun to shine alerted Lorna and Love of Link's fears. Despite that, they couldn't stop nature from taking its course with Zelda's body, whatever the outcome may be. They had all done they could to improve her health. However, it seemed that it was Link with the baby. Much could be done once time came and contractions began assaulting the younger woman's body.
Link, I...
Love started, but was cut short as Zelda gave a particularly loud yell, and her back was arched.
I can see it!
Love gasped as she turned herself back to Zelda.
I can see the head! You keep doing, Zelda!
Your courage, pat yourself. You're doing great! Then stuck. Link merely waited. Let the woman do her work. As he firmly held Zelda's sinking hand with his, kissing her cheek as he whispered in her ear how sorry he was. Everything would be over soon. Her eyes stood still and breathing rapidly. Freeze brought his for comfort, and Link complied, leaning over and kissing tears from her eyes away. It's almost over, Link whispered. It seemed a little reassurance for him than her. Just hold on a little bit longer. Finally, a push ended with a strangled gasp. Link heard Love exclaiming with glee, "It's a boy!" For some reason, Link didn't see her in that glee. Since he fell off, there had been a single sound. Not a pip or cry, nothing. Only silence. It was when Love looked at the bloodstained bundle, smile dropping and eyes widening, that Link had his fears confirmed. His son was dead. A few minutes passed, and the two elder women simply moved together to clean the small baby on a table they had set up in the corner, deadly silent. Their expressions mostly unreadable, but exuding a grim sadness in their eyes. Link was frozen. He was shocked to the point he didn't know what he was feeling anymore. He could feel his heart beating loudly against his chest and coldness surrounding his being, but other than that, he felt nothing. His mind completely blanked out. And Zelda's voice had brought him down to earth against his cruel reality. Nink! Zelda breathed weakly with a smile, exhaustion and fatigue evident in her voice. Oh, baby! Link turned towards her. Her shining eyes met his. Instead of finding happiness and joy in his blue eyes, Zelda saw shock and sadness and disappointment brimming in them.
What is it?
Zelda asked, frightened by his demeanor.
What's wrong?
Link couldn't bring himself to respond. When he finally felt the moisture gathering in the corners of his eyes, he tried to hold him back. Before long, heavy tears began flowing down his cheeks. Zelda's eyes widened in realization. He turned towards the women, holding her arms out.
My baby,
Zelda said breathlessly.
My baby bleeds. Can we hold him?
Both women had looked at each other dubiously, before Werner looked at the newly wrapped bundle in her arms and took it to the blonde woman, carefully laying down her expecting arms. Link couldn't watch. He didn't even want to see what he looked like. He closed his eyes and lowered his head, letting the tears stain the bed sheets. She felt Zelda shuffle beside him to hold the baby properly in her arms. Her sniffled shortly as her eyes skinned the muscleless sun. Link felt more than saw her straighten up and begin to rock back and forth slightly, soothing, rubbing the baby's chest with a hand, pressing ever so slightly on his small rib cage, trying to find the heartbeat that was not there. She began to sing then. Do do do, da da da, da 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 da.
You are waiting all thick for Zelda's lullaby?
Yep.
A soft song that was barely a whisper, broken by the occasional sob leaving her lips. A song that would not reach his son's ears. Link had never heard that song before. He guessed the song Zelda told him about months ago. The lullabies he used to sing her child to sleep every night. A lullaby composed to soothe the senses and drive the scary and sad thoughts away. A lullaby that felt more awake for him. He felt her lay a hand on his head and gestured to come closer. Even though he could pile to move forward, Link was still unwilling to see the little one that he waited so long for and his face in the nape of her neck instead. But he trembled with bottled up emotion and fear rolling down his face. Bit his lip to keep himself from sobbing. A few moments had passed before Zelda finished the lullaby, held both of them close to her. His tears had drenched her nightshirt by now, but Zelda didn't mind, caressed the top of his head as her own tears ran down her face. He felt Zelda move her hand away from his head to caress the baby again, and jump when she finally heard her gasp. After that, he heard a soft, almost impeccable whine, and called back to see what it was. Sound of a weak baby's cry reached his ears. The wailing was sweet, sure, but it was there.
This little scare.
Zelda sniffled with a wide smile.
This is a little scare.
Zelda made a noise that sounded between a laugh and a sob. Tears still flowing down her cheeks as she regarded her son, now writhing slightly in his burgundy wrapping. His little hands ball into fists, and his face floods as he cries to the heavens, as his pleasure having been taken out of his soft, warm womb. Link simply stared with eyes wide, cheeks still damp as Zelda moved the bundle closer to him. The little baby's crying diminished into a low-pitched whining as he tried to move and force his tiny eyes open. They opened a crack, and Link saw beautiful sky blue eyes, much like his, look up at him. Glowed in air like Zelda's covered his tiny head, his stubby pointy ears perked every time the little one heard the sound of his mother's voice. He's beautiful, Zelda commented, all exhaustion and fatigue gone from her face. She beamed at a little piece of joy.
He looks so much like you.
Yeah, Link said distractedly as he took in the image of his very much alive son, grabbing his larger index finger and squeezing it with his tiny, stubby fingers. He looked a little under the weather with his white skin, only slightly rosy. But he was alive, and that was all that mattered. Their son was alive. They were both alive. A strange surge of uncontrollable emotions hit him then. Feelings of relief, happiness, pride, and gratitude flooded his senses as Link broke down, sobbing, tears running unchecked as he grinned and embraced the two most precious people in his life close. Zelda looked down and nuzzled his face and slinked down to plant a very wet kiss on her lips. Zelda gave a giggle rather than a sloppy gesture, lowered her head to kiss her son's forehead. Housing a little baby to coo quickly at them.
Back at home, little Daphne's. Poor little heart.
Okay. This fic was really good. Heart-wrenching, dramatic, happy, and sad. It was a really great Legend of Zelda fanfic, and I'm glad that this was the first one we got to do on the show. It was so wonderful to just sit through and enjoy every single moment.
One thing I do love about Legend of Zelda when it comes to being a silent protagonist for Link is that while we can put our own thoughts about who Link is and what each one of the different reincarnations are all about, what their personalities are, I also feel like there was a strange way that each one of them could have their own potential of saying who they are, and what type of characters they are. I mean, for instance, if you'll know a little bit some of Link's in Skyward Sword's more emotional personality, you'll see that he's a lot more emotional and a lot more sleepy and tired. Arnora Time Link is a much more dead set child hero, willing to push through and do everything he can to save the princess. See, somehow, in some way, even without saying a word, all the different Links approve themselves to have different personalities and different character traits.
Yeah, I suppose that means I should be a little more courteous towards a certain cartoon that has a certain set sense, that a certain meme that really annoys me, but we'll get back to that.
Still, this does a good job of doing all the proper emotions and really drags you into this particular Link. It makes you feel compassion for the scenes that are going on. Which, all in all, is exactly what you need. Another great story down, and that was one down, thousands more to go. I'll see you all next time.